Hello, I'm Charlotte Atchley, editor of Baking and Snack Magazine. Today, I'm joined by Tasos Katsaounis, president and CEO of Breadman Baking, which is featured in our July issue. Thanks for being with me today, Tasos.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So let's start by talking about Breadman Baking's foundation for growth. Why did you go into the baking industry, and what has made your business so successful?
That's a great question because it's such a unique story. I went into the baking industry because the baking industry more or less found me. I spent 22 years of my professional career in management consulting, but I started baking bread at a very young age of 10 years old. My parents were Greek immigrants, so out of necessity, my mother used to make bread for us at home on a weekly basis. And being a young kid that I was attached to my mother's hip in the kitchen when she would cook or bake. And so it became a weekly ritual, if you will, between us. If you fast forward to 2017, I was in a very, very stressful role at the last company that I worked for before I made this, quote, pivot. I started baking again out of a conversation that I had with my wife about her, deceased father regarding bread. And at that point, my wife had no idea that I knew how to make bread. And so out of that conversation, I started baking and I realized I was probably doing it more to escape the rigors and the stresses and the pressures of my career at the time. And I really enjoyed it. And out of, you know, many of rescheduling or scheduling Zoom calls, and because I worked 100% remotely from my home, I would actually find myself scheduling meetings around the process of making bread at home. And so shortly after I started baking bread here in Houston at home, I started to receive intrigue, if you will, or interest by your everyday consumer, but then soon following, it became evident that there were potential wholesale capability or opportunities here because I started getting contacted by hotels and local chefs, and they had found me just through my personal social media pages, which I wasn't advertising that this bread is available. It was just more of look at my pretty bread. And from there, it just kind of snowballed to the point to where I had to make a decision with my wife. What should we do about it? Because it was pretty obvious and very evident that we had found something had found me, if you will. I've never enjoyed my previous career, truth be told. Was very good at it and was successful, but I didn't get the personal satisfaction that most people seek out for their, you know, careers and passions. This was a passion, and I discovered quickly that I could probably make something out of it. And so we sat down and made that conscious decision with three kids, and both of us being a two-income family, so it enabled us to do this, and we took the leap. And that's how it more or less got started.
In our July issue, you gave us a tour of your brand new 40,000 square foot facility. You opened that in December of 2021, which was like right in the middle of the pandemic. What prompted you to do that?
You know, we did a lot of, obviously, research leading up to this point. I know a lot of people also have had similar questions to me of why on earth did you think that was a good idea? And to me, it actually seemed like it was the perfect timing for us as a company to expand into that larger facility. You know, to be honest, we were in a significantly smaller facility that was approximately 4,800 square feet that had no we had maxed out the facility. It had no room for growth. There was no opportunities for us to add any additional equipment to increase oven capacities or throughputs. The space wasn't very conducive to efficiencies. It's kind of thrown together, if you will. And so we thought, look, we'd built a sales pipeline that was targeting more frozen opportunities for distribution. And there was no way it could be done out of that facility. So we thought, okay, look, we've got opportunity here. People are still buying bread. Food service is still buying bread. Got to figure this out. So we did a lot of market research. I went out and actually have formed relationships with other bakeries in the country and in the industry who opened their door, very kind to open their doors to me to really kind of give me just some insight for questions that I had just to learn and understand. where I need to place focus on expansion. Biggest question I had was, how big of a space do I need? And I was very fortunate to find the space that I moved into, because it really checked all the boxes for what we were looking for. And it was available. And so we thought, look, economically, it made sense. The building had, you know, all the things that we were looking for to expand ourselves into. And, you know, it was obviously a risk to open and expand a new facility of this size from what we were in during the heart of the pandemic, as well as all the logistical and supply chain issues that came out of that same time, which did delay us by 5 to 6 months. And it was costlier than we expected because of those supply chain and delay issues. But, you know, when you look around the industry in that during that time, there were a lot of bakeries that were unfortunately experiencing similar delays in logistics, supply chains, and even labor issues. And their unfortunate realities was opening doors for other bakeries that weren't necessarily experiencing the labor issues or experiencing quality issues because of labor or because of supply chain or whatever the purpose was. And so, you know, we weren't experiencing any labor issues. We actually were able to scale up and double our workforce within the first couple of months of moving into the new facility to properly, you know, prepare us for what we were hoping to do, which is what we're doing now, producing, you know, artisan bread at volume and at scale. So we thought, look, there's actually a pretty good reason why we're doing this, and we feel like we could benefit from it as a company, and we took the risk, and I believe the risk was worth taking.
That's wonderful to hear that you were able to not have to deal with so much some of those challenges that other bakers have been struggling with.
For us, the logistics and supply chain issues really only applied to us when it came down to the construction and final build out of the facility and getting some equipment here. So yes, naturally we did experience in that, but regarding labor issues and finding, you know, skilled people that really wanted to work and wanted to be a part of our culture, we didn't have that issue. And we weren't seeing any dip in quality or consistency issues in production because of that. And so we thought, you know what, this is our time. This is our time to really go after the business we want to target, go after the type of customers that we want to target, demonstrate what we can do as an artisan bakery at scale. The biggest thing I've heard a lot is, how in the heck do you think you can scale them to a space 10 times the size of what you were in previously and still maintain all of that? And I think we're doing a pretty good job of that based on the new customers we've brought in, the types of products we're putting out now in the new facility. It's been a lot of hard work and some challenges, sure, but it's working out.
So you mentioned your career as a consultant. If you were consulting for other artisan bakers looking to expand, what advice would you give them from all the lessons you've learned over the past 5 years?
Yeah, that's a great question, because there's so many lessons learned that I've learned over the course of this journey. And keep in mind, I'm a data-driven and an analytical guy because of my career. So I like to think I did a lot of my due diligence and homework on the front end before making some key strategic decisions. But the reality is I didn't have a manufacturing or a professional baking background either. So there was still a lot of room for growth in my education of what it would take to be in my position and to have a company like this and what it means for it to be successful. This is more expensive, if you will, of a undertaking than I ever anticipated. So, you know, one of the things I would highly recommend outside of the standards of, you know, do your due diligence. Who is your customer? What's your purpose? How do you want to communicate that? Communicate your purpose and your statement of, you know, who makes you who you are as a company and representing your brand to potential customers. I would also tell, you know, but also understand what costs come with that, because my initial thought on what it costs to stand up even a 4,800 square foot bakery was way off. And there was a lot of ancillary smaller things that ended up becoming bigger things. So along the way, like I mentioned earlier, I've been very fortunate to make to form relationships with other bakery owners who have really given me a lot of insight. And for me, I would absolutely tell someone, don't be afraid to open your doors to someone. You know, obviously you don't want to share proprietary information for obvious reasons, but you know, there, I've learned a lot from people like Greg Acera at Fire King Bakery, who's become a friend, from Didier Rosada at Uptown Bakers in Maryland, who's been so kind, and him and Mike McLeod have been so kind to open their doors to let me in, to tour their facilities, to pick their brains, to understand what hurdles am I going to go, you know, am I going to deal with. Mediterra, the boys up in Mediterra, who's another Greek family like myself, who've been around in Pittsburgh for 20, 25 years. Those guys are wonderful people, and we form relationship. And albeit we've never visited each other's bakery, we are always asking each other questions about things. To me, that's been the biggest asset for me, is surrounding myself with people that are smarter than me. And that would be a one key piece of advice that I would give anyone who has any ambitions of doing this, that similarly to me had no previous experience going into this type of industry for the first time and making such a leap from my previous career, is, you know, don't be afraid to form relationships. They can benefit you. And also surround yourself with people that are smarter than you. I don't know everything. I've been at this for almost 5 years. I still don't know everything here, right? I learned something new from my company teaches me something new every day, and my team especially teaches me something new every day. But you know, it's a very simple answer in the aspect of, and I realize it's long-winded, but you know, I did my homework, but I'm probably confident that I may not have done as much homework as I realized I was doing, or the correct type of homework, leading into it. You know, I rewrote my business plan 4 or 5 times, because every time it just kept, the company kept going in its own direction, and it wanted to grow at the pace it wanted to grow. And that was a little scary for me, because you don't want to grow too quickly, because that's not necessarily the best decision as opposed to slower growth. You've got to find that happy medium. But yeah, that's more or less for me what's really helped me kind of guide me through this journey, is, you know, I'm not afraid to ask questions, even when it comes down to other potential bakeries. And luckily, these bakers that I know are in other parts of the country, so we don't necessarily step on each other's toes for, in terms of business. But it's been a great community to be a part of. I've learned a lot from some of the more successful ones that are out there that have been at it for a long time. And I'd be happy to share any lessons learned from anyone who's approached me, you know, that are in a similar starting point as I was. But it's been a lot of fun to learn. I mean, I love to learn. I consume like this, kind of not just ambitiously, but I mean, I'm obsessed with what we do here every day, and it's a passion and a love for what I do. So hopefully that helps someone.
Tasos, you mentioned getting started in the kitchen with your mom when you were 10. On a personal note, as we wrap up our conversation, what does Breadman Baking mean to you and your family?
Oh, I mean, you know, there's a deep-rooted family legacy in this business, even though the company is as young as it was. It wasn't started by my parents. It wasn't started by my grandparents, and I inherited it. Obviously, it was started by me out of my home kitchen, but you know, my grandmother back in the village in Greece taught my mother to make bread, and they made bread similarly that my mom taught me when I was 10 in my hometown of Dallas, Texas, and where I learned how to make bread with her. And then now I do the same with my children, and hopefully one day, you know, they'll get involved in the near future. But there's very deep rooted. The legacy for my family is what's super important to me, because I need purposely. I need this brand and this company to reflect the values of my grandmother's and my mother's. And when it comes down to the quality of the product that we're producing every day, but also to the consistency of it, and the artisan side of it as well. That to us is super important, is not taking the shortcuts, not putting, you know, using ingredients that you can't pronounce. Things like that are what's super key and important to us. But really, it's, you know, it was always my dream to find something that I loved in my career, and I never knew what that was. And so for this to have kind of happened the way that it did, I don't take it for granted at all. So I take every advantage of this opportunity that I have every day to build something that my family and my mother and my grandmother can be proud of, and my wife and my kids.
Well, thank you so much, Tasos, for speaking with me today and being willing to share your bakery story with our audience.
Sure. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.